Alright everybody, sorry for the long absence. I've had a lot of stuff going on this year. New cars, vacations, kids, life. You know how it goes. This is summer of 2016, Journey to My Benches. We're going to start out with the corkbark elm. As you can see, nice large canopy. I found some wood boring beetles on one of the trunks, and you can see the damage that these things do in a very short amount of time. Just completely ate out the whole back side of this. If you have a bonsai tree and you start seeing sawdust that looks very similar to that, looks like there's still possibly one in there active. I'm gonna have to check that out here in a minute. That's an indicator that you have wood borers in your tree. And I've been treating it with Bayer Advanced Tree and Shrub. And it's a systemic, so you've got to get it in the soil, into the tree, and then it'll kill those insects from when they eat the cambrium layer. Wasn't planning on using that piece at all, thank goodness, because it's just a long, straight, no taper piece. It's actually going to be cut off clear down here. This is the front that I see, and this is pretty much the part of the tree I'm going to be using. So, you know, kind of dodged a bullet there, I guess, in a way. I'm going to try to air layer this piece off. And so I'm going to have to cut it there. So we've got a lot of work to do on that tree. It's going to be years and years and years and years before it ever amounts to anything, but it's just got an absolutely massive base on it. Base is just absolutely huge. But it's doing well. Next we'll go over here. This is one of the black pines that I have, and this is the second year, I believe, or third year I've had this tree. As you can see, I let it candle out in the very first week of July, because I don't get winter down here until like February. I cut those candles back and left just a little teeny nub, and you can see it's back budding. Focus please. It has back budded from where my cut sites are. You can see I cut it right there. Just leave a couple millimeters, really. Here's a good shot of what I'm talking about right here. So just left a few millimeters of stump, and you can see it's back budded from that cut site. So what I'm going to have to go through and do is each one of these that has three, I'm going to select two, the weakest two, eliminating the stronger one. And that helps with ramification as well as trying to get some back budding down in here. You can see these are very long node. It's right here's the branch, and you got all this way out here at the very end. So I'm trying to push it back as much as I can. So that's one of the ways you can try to get that done. And also, I don't want it to get any more extension growth than what it has already, because we need to figure out what we're going to do with this tree. I don't know if I'm going to keep this tree or not, to be quite honest with you. This spring, I was lucky enough to get this tree, and it's a black pine as well, and it's just phenomenal. Didn't think I'd ever get a black pine of this caliber, ever. So it's a very, very nice tree. It's got a really large trunk on it. As you can see, it's probably about 5-inch, 6-inch diameter trunk. This tree was collected this spring, and it grew so strong. And I do not advocate this ever, but I felt, because of the amount of roots that are underneath this soil that I got when the tree was collected, the ease I was able to get the sandy soil off of it and straight into here, I'm telling you, I had probably 6 to 8 inch long candles on this tree. So I went ahead and did the same technique I did to this tree. This tree's been growing in this soil for 2 years now, and I'm just now getting to this technique here. But this thing grew so strong that I went ahead and did the same thing. And if you look closely, it's back budded as well, all over the place. Some I only got one on, and then I got some like this that I've got four on. So I'm gonna, here in the next few weeks, I'm gonna have to kind of do the same thing with it and just, you know, select the two weakest buds of each piece. Here's a couple shots of it here. It's got a really nice wiggle no matter what area you look at it from. I'm thinking that this branch right here is probably going to be eliminated. I got to figure something out. Maybe that right there will be number one branch. This up here will be number two branch or something. I don't know. I got to kind of, the rules are kind of not really going to apply on one branch and two branch on this tree, because this is just long extension growth and it's just got a bunch out here at the very end, and there's absolutely nothing here. So that's not going to be conducive for a branch. So I got to figure something out there. I'm thinking maybe one, two, using this and bringing it down into this area. And then I'm have this here for the back and that side, and then utilize the rest of this up here as the top, up here as the top part of the tree. So we'll see how that goes. Next we come over here. This is the red pine. I did the same technique to this tree at the same time of year, and I don't selectively cut candles. Every single one of these trees, I chopped every candle off the same time, the same day. And this tree's actually been growing for 3 years to get its vigor back up before I did this technique. And if you look closely here, I'm getting the same thing here. I'm getting bud pop after I pinched. There's the candles that I cut. There was three of them here. I cut three candles and I only got one back bud, which is fine. But other ones I've gotten more. There's three on that one. So, as you can see, here's some more. So it's doing well. It's doing well. It did its job. It did exactly what I was hoping it would do. Of course, I'm not getting any back budding back in here like I was wanting to, but on a red pine, really, to be honest with you, beggars can't be choosers. Bjorn is going to be in my area next month, and I'm hoping to attend a workshop with him. And if I'm allowed, if I can get a hall pass from the wife to do so, I'm going to. And I'm going to take this tree, I'm going to take this tree, and I'm going to take this tree. And I'm going to let him see all three, and I'm going to let him make a decision as to which one he thinks that would be best to work on at the time. My guess is it's probably going to be this tree. I'm really kind of hoping just this tree, because it's an all-day deal. There's only six people that are allowed in the class, and it's an eight or nine-hour workshop. So I'm hoping I can get maybe this one back in line or get this one's initial styling done here. So we'll see what happens. Next is the Nyer that everybody saw. I did the wiring video on this spring and everything. It's going nuts. I'm letting it do that intentionally because John Green of Green Thumb Bonsai is going to be coming over here very soon and going to be cutting all these long extension growth off to make he's going to propagate by cuttings on this tree because we're getting low on that stock. And so there's also going to be some news at the end of this video that I'm really excited about, and hopefully some of you will get excited about as well. But more on that in a second. Big Daddy Trident Maple, it's doing really well. Got the leader established. It's starting to extend. Come over here so you can see a little bit better. I've got this branch here is my number one branch. I'm going to have to wire it out for too long. Number two branch here. I've got here for another one, here for another one, here for another one, and then of course everything up at the top. So I've got everything established there. We're going to wire that one and do the work next spring on the initial styling of that after we've done our trunk carving and everything. So the real, I guess you could say, first styling of that tree with branches will be done then. This here is just a little Japanese maple that I got for free at a nursery. Well, I say for free, I think it was like 25 bucks. I got it because it's got a nice trunk and nice nabari. Really nice nabari. It's got good taper. It's got some pretty large scarring there, but it's healing very well, just like all the rest of my Japanese maples. And had one branch here, it's kind of weak. It's still alive, but it's just a little weak. I wired a few branches out on it and was hoping I could get some bud push from this that I saw as the leader, but looks like it's dead, so I'm going to have to do some redesigning of that one. Back there behind it's a Jacqueline Hillary elm. I don't have one, and as most of you know, I'm focusing on elms and maples. This tree's like 15, 20 years old and just has never done well for some reason. But if you look closely here, I've got a couple root suckers. And so I'm hoping to maybe harvest one of those and put it in my growing bed so I can grow a large trunk of that tree so I can have a nice size elm. This Nyer 2.0, I've got a couple here as well for propagation purposes. I think there's two of them there, maybe three of them there, that are coming up off of one of the root shoots that I can use for propagation purposes as well. This, what I thought was an American elm, a good friend of mine, John Jean Angel, let me know that he believes that's a hop hornbeam, but it is a native, so I'm going to keep it, because I am focusing on doing some native species as well as elms and maples. So it's pretty good. I got it in a pot finally, and I'm going to be working on ramification here. I've got to cut all this back here in the next week or two so we can start working on getting some ramification on these main branches. Crimson Queen, doing well. Don't need to spend a lot of time on that because I'm going to be shooting more videos of these guys once we start doing some more work on them. I just got done watering everything. That's why it has this two-ton looking bark here, wet, dry. Sharp's Pygmy, doing real well. The heels, the squirrel damage is healing over really well. I'm hoping maybe in the next couple years I can get this one into a bonsai pot as well and start getting it ready for a show. I just don't know if that's going to be feasible or not. Trident Maple, the drastic redesigned Trident Maple, as you can see, the squirrel knocked the branch off here, and this was the bud in the beginning of the spring that grew. I'm letting these sacrifice branches, these two as well, grow straight up. That's thickening this branch very rapidly. You can see I've got one here as well. I cut it back once, and that's where I've gotten all this back budding and leafing here. So I did that, and then I let the secondary branching grow vigorously. And what happens is when I cut all this secondary stuff back off, this is the stuff that will be retained, and this is the stuff that's going to develop as ramification. I've got this one here doing the same kind of the same thing. And of course the apex going up. This is a new one this year. This is just a green Japanese maple, but it's got a really nice nabari and a really decent sized trunk, maybe 4.5-5 inches. And so it's just a mess. I'm just letting it back bud and letting it grow unchecked this year. I'll be doing a video on this one this fall. We're going to start styling on that one as well. The Kashima. Kashima's doing good. Of course, it's a basally dominant tree, as you all probably know if you've watched any of my other videos. So there's nothing in the center top, because when I cut it all back, it all died back, and all the undergrowth portion of it was still stayed alive. So what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be wiring a bunch of stuff up this fall and getting it into position so that next year it'll have some semblance of a tree. But it's doing well. Trident Maple, my very first video I shot of it, thread graft here 3 years ago. I've been keeping it cut back for ramification on this side, which is doing good. This is the thread graft that finally took, the second thread graft that finally took. I'm keeping it cut back for ramification, and hopefully I may be able to get some back budding in here. And then I'm keeping the rest of it, as you can see, cut back to try to force the energy back down into these branches here. So, Pyracantha, doing well. I've got to trim some growth off the back side of it here, but it's taken its transplanting very well into its new pre-bonsai container. I got tons of bright branching. You can barely see it because I got so many weeds and trees kind of crammed together. In the summer down here, it's like 8 o'clock at night right now and 98 degrees, so I try to keep them a little bit closer together than I normally would, which helps with humidity. But that branch did make it, and it's alive and full. This branch did make it, and it's alive and full. Top's looking good. Let me see if I can back up a little bit so you can see the whole tree. There you go. Happy with the progress on that one. Of course, right next to it's my coral bark that I did the redesign on. Right here's the new front, and it just looks like a mess. Apex is growing like crazy, thickening up, healing that big scar that we made at the very top. Got a lot of back branching and back budding that I'm letting just kind of grow out so we can select next year and get that one back on track and get it growing really well. Chalk bark maple, doing real well. This year, luckily, this year, I caught this thing at the right time. As soon as it started branching out, I came out here and pinched every single growing tip on the entire tree. And I didn't get as much extension growth this year as I normally do. It stayed more compact than it normally does. So I think that might be the trick with these chalk bark native maples here, and maybe even some other native maples to the United States, is when they first start coming out, you gotta pinch every single growing tip, leaving one set, maybe two sets of leaves in there, and it stops that extension growth immediately. So I think that might be the trick for these. Next up is the Trident maple that we did the journey to the nursery for bonsai material. The apex got busted out of it, so I've been having to regrow a new apex, and I'm getting eaten up by mosquitoes, so I need to kind of wrap it up here pretty quick. I had an apex in here that was perfect. It was like right there. You see it? It was right there. It died. This one came up, and I've been letting it grow. It's kind of too far forward, though. I'm going to have to regrow another apex on this, or maybe do a cut back. I don't know. We're going to have to figure something out on this one. I kind of got discouraged with it and just letting it do its thing for now, and we'll see what happens with that one. This is an Arakawa. I tried to do some thread grafting on this spring. Didn't seem to work out. This here is an Arakawa. That there's an Arakawa. I've got two of them in 1-inch pots. Growing some whips off of them, so I can maybe try some thread grafting here in the summer. See if those may take a little bit better. We'll be doing that in the next week or so. Next up is the Stewardia. It's doing very well, full of leaves. I've got a lot of back budding happening this year down low. I need to take care of that stuff and clean it up. I'm kind of happy that it's back budding all over the old wood. Now I know that it does that. I'm probably going to be cutting it back pretty severe this next spring. Had a little bit of branch dieback from the winter, but that's to be expected on this kind of tree. So that brings us back to the Chinese elm. These are the two, and the other small Japanese maple I have left. I'm just kind of developing, and maybe I'm going to auction these off eventually. But they're doing good. They've got a lot of extension growth, and they're happy being understory trees here, and they got nice trunks on them, nice nabaris on them. Decent taper. We're working on back budding, some lower branching and everything, so they're all doing well. But the one thing I wanted to let everybody know about is it's going to be a little bit in later in the works, but I am in the process of trying to accomplish. I bought some land, and I'm in the process, and that's why I haven't had very many videos up, and I do apologize for that, but I've been very, very busy at this land. I'm trying to get it established and set up. I got 22 acres about an hour away from where I live, and I'm going to start up a bonsai nursery there. I've already got 1,500 seedlings ready to be planted this fall in the ground, and I'm working on getting ceramic tiles to put each one of them on, so I'll have really nice nabaris and really nice trunks and everything. John Green, Green Thumb Bonsai, not getting any younger. He and I have been talking for quite some time. When he decides to hang it up, he's got to have a place for his trees to go. I'm accommodating that, as well as growing my own stock there. So I'm really excited about that. I've just been working really hard. Just had a lot of life events happen this year, but I'm plugging along. But I'm excited. It's one of my dreams to have my own bonsai nursery, and it looks like it's going to be a reality, and I'm really excited about that. It's going to be somewhere where I'm not necessarily living primarily. It's going to be a off-site location, but I'll be able to grow my own stock in the ground, be able to go and put my hands on it every year and develop it in the ground, and hopefully 5 to 10 years from now have some of the best bonsai material in the Southeast available for sale. I'm not getting any younger. Eventually I'm going to have to retire, and this is what I want to pursue when I retire, so why not start now? So this video has been long enough. I want to thank all of you for watching, and take care, and we'll see you on the next one.